Now, I don't think there's enough evidence right now for me to hang my hat on any dietary prescription for sleep. In 5 years' time, I think we'll have a very different conversation. I think, you know, absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. I think we'll get there, and I think food is going to be a big part of that equation. I think the gut microbiome, too. I think that's what we've seen. When you, in a few of the studies where you limit people, you sleep deprive them, or you put them on a jet lag routine, you see the balance between the sort of bacteriodites sort of class of the microbiome versus the formicutes. That ratio goes in a balance that you don't want. So typically in sort of obese people or people with diabetes, you get a higher ratio of the formicutes relative to the bacteriodites. When you modulate sleep and you shortchange sleep or you put sleep on a jet-lag profile, that's exactly the same gut microbiome sort of dysregulation profile that you see. Wow. So I think it's going to be a great, and I think part of
they're on their own circadian rhythm as well, the bacteria.
They are, and they, yeah.
So is that why? Because their ratio is changing?
I think it's possible that it could be a circadian rhythm. I think it's also possible that it could be down to what we described before, which is the fight or flight branch of the nervous system, that when you are underslept, it's like revving a car, but in neutral. It's desperately bad for the engine. That's what happens when you're sleep deprived. You get this ramping up of your fight or flight system, and it just stays there with chronic sleep deprivation for as long as you're chronically sleep deprived. And one out of every two adults in first world nations is chronically sleep deprived. I think it leads to a release of stress chemistry, particularly cortisol. Cortisol is known in the gut microbiome to produce this imbalance. What's the pathway? I think it's probably a bunch of nerve fibers from the brain into the body called the vagus nerve, and we're starting to do a lot of work on this now. I think the vagus nerve we know has a direct mainline pathway, or provides a mainline pathway from your brain to your gut, and that's why there is a very powerful brain-gut relationship. I think that's one of the mechanisms by which the gut is affected by sleep, which gets me excited because if that's true, flip the equation. Could the gut microbiome be a path through which we can reverse engineer a signal for better sleep in the brain?
Yeah.
I think that now becomes a parsimonious hypothesis, and it's one that I'd like to test as well.
There was a really interesting study looking at the effects of a particular strain. I think it was the rhamnosus strain they produce GABA in the gut.
Yes.
But GABA doesn't cross the blood-brain barrier as far as I think most evidence suggests. It does not.
No.
But
so the brain has GABA, but it's not
right,
coming from the
right.
brain. Yep.
But there was some studies that were sort of speculating that there's through the vagal nerve, because some of the efferent neurons in the gut were stimulating it and they were more like relaxed or something. They were producing GABA in the brain through the vagal nerve. And GABA affects sleep, right? So there'd be some,
yeah.
It sounds like there could definitely be some sort of
interesting. And that's one of the things in anxiety that we see, is that it's a failure of the brain to dampen down and basically invoke inhibition throughout mm-hmm. the brain to quiet down these regions.
That particular strain of probiotics was shown to help with anxiety. Small trials, clinical trials in humans. Of course, the initial studies were preclinical in animals. But it has been shown to actually help improve anxiety.
It does?
Yeah.
My guess is that if that's true, if you were to look at sleep, I would be surprised not to see a sleep benefit by way of an anxiety reduction. In my lab, that's probably one of the most reliable things that we see when we deprive people of sleep of any dose.
That the anxiety goes up?
Anxiety goes up. And it's almost, we've done the dose response curve. We've looked, hour by hour by hour. And as soon as you get past probably about 14 or 15 hours of wakefulness, anxiety starts to increase.